We're now about to get into what's going to be a very exciting panelist about next generation entrepreneurs in the island of Ireland. We're joined by three of these next generation entrepreneurs. We have Deepa Mann-Kler, founder and chief executive of Neon. We have Sean O'Connor, co-founder of StatSports, and we have Kate Madden, co-founder and head of global sales at FenuHealth. Deepa, first of all, could you maybe take us through your journey? Just tell us about founding the company, tell us about coming to Northern Ireland and why that was a good place for you to found your business.
So I arrived in Northern Ireland in 1996, and I've had several careers. So I arrived here as a researcher and wrote the first report into racism in Northern Ireland just after the ceasefires, and worked on equality for 11 years. Then was an artist for 11 years. And then 2016, I experienced virtual reality and was so overwhelmed by the impact and the power of this medium that I decided to set up a company, which is largely health focused. And I now have, it's a largely an R&D company producing prototypes in terms of virtual and augmented reality that are very creative, but have a health and well-being focus.
And whereabouts are you based these days?
So I'm based in County Down in Northern Ireland.
And has that been a supportive environment to grow your business?
Yeah, it has been. Obviously, I connect into Belfast quite a lot because that's where a lot of the support comes from. So in terms of the business in 2018, I was fortunate enough to get onto an incubator, a six-month incubator with Propel, run by Ignite NI and funded by Invest NI. So that was a six-month support package for as a tech company, along with 19 other companies based at Ormo Baths. And it, as well as providing mentoring for 6 months in terms of all aspects of exploring, you know, startup needs. It also provided a £15,000 grant and an office space, and was actually a really, really useful incubator. And then alongside that, I've had ongoing support from Catalyst Inc., Invest NI in terms of trade missions to America, and then also attendance at a virtual medicine conference in LA, which was really, really useful in terms of growing the business.
And as you grew your business, did you look south at all, or is there a cross-border aspect to your business?
So there is a cross-border aspect that has emerged over the last couple of years. One of the other aspects of my business is that I speak at conferences and very much showcasing the benefits of XR and healthcare in terms of innovation and how it can be adopted by different aspects of healthcare. And I would speak on a regular basis down south. Obviously, this has slowed down after COVID. But beyond that, no, there hasn't been. And it's intriguing that, you know, I didn't think to the south when I was exploring markets for the company back in 2018, because that and in terms of looking at R&D partnerships and collaborations, it just wasn't on the radar. I looked east to Great Britain and then west to America into terms of collaborations, but not down south. And I think there's something around a kind of cultural mindset or barrier, or those mechanisms and partnerships that just aren't in place to encourage young tech startups in terms of developing those collaborations.
Yeah, I think that is super interesting. And I definitely want to unpick later why it is that businesses in Northern Ireland don't naturally look south as they evolve. And also, I think, Kate, you had a similar perspective building a business in the south and not really looking north. Maybe you could talk us through that.
Yeah, so my name is Kate Madden and I'm the co-founder of FenuHealth. So FenuHealth more or less supplies a range of products to the equine industry, so horses, like stomach problems. And yeah, I'm from based in County Meath, but I go to college in Cork. I'm in UCC. But when we started up our business, we really did notice that we don't really have that cross-border effect. And I mean, you could probably blame it on the market, saying that it's small, But at the end of the day, that can be fixed with an agent or some other company that's up north. But for me, as I'm only 20, the big thing is that it really comes down to, like, my generation don't remember what happened between the north and the south. We're completely new to it all, that it really makes no difference to us to go up north as it does to England. It's more our parents' generation that kind of, we'd never travel to the north with our parents on like holidays, staycation. It was always we'd go to mainland Britain. And I think even with my company, like we sell to 15 countries around the world now, and Northern Ireland, they really only hold up to about 0.5%, I'd say, of sales compared to mainland Britain, where it is 30 times the size. And I think that really emphasizes like how southern companies and companies down south sometimes just don't really think about putting the effort in and putting the emphasis on Northern Ireland when it's literally, for me, an hour up the road, you know, compared to going across to England or mainland Britain. So I think it's definitely the mental barrier that we've been brought up with due to older generations, whereas my age group, we don't see any difference between the north, south. And I think that really is the way forward. It's kind of educating people, educating my age group as to that the north and south, we're all one country at the end of the day. We're all on the island of Ireland. And it's really strange to me to even think that those mental barriers are still there today.
Yeah, and we definitely want to unpick and also maybe take some suggestions from the audience, because we have a number of really experienced business people, like really experienced policy people, who can maybe make suggestions about how entrepreneurs on both sides of the border can really go north, can really go south, and how you can break down those barriers. Sean, I want to bring you in here. You're the co-founder of StatSports. You have the, I guess, on this panel, a unique situation of having operated from both sides of the border. Maybe talk us through your experience there.
Yeah, thanks, Laura. I'm sitting right now in our office in Newry, and this morning I came from my house, which is just outside Dundalk. So on a daily basis, or when we can come to the office, I'm crossing the border, as are 50% of our staff. So we have a staff here in Newry of in excess of 100 at the moment. And yeah, we started our business, both Alan and I founded the business, are both originally from Dundalk. And we initially, the idea, we based in the Regional Development Centre within DKITP. And that was fantastic for us at the time, from a hub to be able to start the business, to tap into the resources within DKIT from software development and hardware, engineering, technology. Neither Alan nor I had those backgrounds. So we knew that we needed to tap into the right people and places to get that. And to DKIT, we're perfect for that. As we grew, we often get asked, why did two lads from Dundalk then bring a business across the border when a lot of companies in the world are bringing their business to Ireland, to the south? And at the time, there was various reasons. Our client base was, I suppose, small and growing, and the main focus was on the Premier League in England, that's professional teams within, I suppose, the mainland UK. But also we had a huge helping hand through the process from Invest and I, and still to this day, they've been fantastic for us. But that being said, we're definitely now at a stage of our growth that we recognise a need to be on both sides. It doesn't have to be one or the other. And there are definitely benefits for being north for us. There are huge benefits to being south as well. And we're at a stage where we recognize that that's something that we can do. And it's recognizing that. And I even see it internally. We have a fantastic team growing here in StatSports. And we can think too parochial, too regional. And even when it comes to recruitment, we've made the mistake subconsciously of just identifying recruitment companies who specialize in identifying people in Belfast. We have staff who currently come from the office. There's a guy here not too long ago was from Blackrock, South County Dublin. We have staff who come from North Belfast. We're right in the middle of the Dublin to Belfast economic corridor. So we should be using that for advantage. And sometimes we just seem to think of ourselves too parochial and we're just a Northern Ireland company. We're an Irish company on the island of Ireland, and we need to make sure, and it's something that Deepa said, there's definitely a cultural mindset. It's not necessarily, there's physical barriers, there's not real obstacles in a way other than opening our thinking to it as well.
In terms of those physical barriers, how difficult is it? Like, if you're an entrepreneur and you have a relatively small company, say it's your first company, it's your first time doing this, you're hearing all this stuff about the trade after Brexit, about how complicated it is, how difficult it is. How difficult is it to get established on both sides of the border?
The short answer for me is hiring the right people who can deal with that. For me, because that's not a world of information that I can, the detail around that. We have great people who can make sure that we're looking ahead. And the biggest challenge with Brexit for 2-3 years was the unknown, not knowing what form that was going to take and how can you prepare for something that you're not entirely sure what that is going to mean for you and your business. So you can prepare as best you can for all eventualities, but at some point you have to move on from that. I do think we're in a unique position on this island to get the best of both worlds and to be able to become a hub, be that Dundalk, Newry, Dublin, Belfast, and everywhere in between. We're definitely in a place to maximize the opportunities. We have clients all around the world, and when we go to the likes of the US, being from the island of Ireland is something that really plays into our hands. When we're talking to clubs and clients in mainland UK, for example, we have three airports, Dublin and Belfast airports, that are within an hour of our office. So we have to focus on the things that we can control and that are positives and use them to our advantage, and not on the things that we can't and the unknowns and what might happen. And that's a big thing that I think is from a cultural, from a political, from a business commercial point of view, there are certain things that we can get lost and get down negative rabbit holes and it's hard to come back from them.
Thank you. I think that's a really good point. Deepa, I'm going to come to you next. One of the things I asked you all to do before this session was to think about what could have encouraged you to take a more cross-border approach to your business as it was growing. So Deepa, back when you were setting up, what kind of things would have encouraged you to look south more in terms of business opportunities, in terms of funding, in terms of staff?
I think if there were programs where, even the Propel program that I participated in, you know, there's no reason that there couldn't have been companies maybe from the South. So the design and the build of the program is all island in terms of its approach, or all island mechanisms in terms of being able to explore markets in terms of innovation and health, or partnerships or testing of new products and services. It's very hard to do that if you are a tech startup and there are sort of so many things that you're already learning. To then to have to start up those partnerships and arrangements by yourself is quite daunting. You just don't do it. So what you then tend to do is you are to those arrangements that are already in place. And you also, I suppose, get sidetracked in terms of where there's funding already available as well. And perhaps awareness. I mean, those platforms may exist, but I'm not overly aware of them. So what I have done then is sort of where I can control and where it doesn't take an enormous amount of effort. For example, the speaking at conferences and events where I can actually really, really demonstrate the benefits and use cases of virtual and augmented reality in health. That's been much easier to carve out and target. But I do think, I think sort of what are all the unmissed opportunities and partnerships are out there in terms of services and goods perhaps that aren't being met at the minute that could come through that greater all-island collaboration and partnership and dialogue. So this is a really, really good start, just this initiative.
Okay, thank you so much for that. And Kate, I know you and your sister were 14 and 15, I think, when you founded your company and came up through the BT Young Scientists. So you were obviously very young, and it would have been quite hard, I guess, for you guys to start looking north on your own. But what do you think would have been helpful or in terms of making you consider the island of Ireland rather than kind of considering the Republic of Ireland and then looking overseas effectively, which seems to be the route that a lot of companies take?
Even speaking about the BT Young Scientists, like straight off the board, that competition is 32 counties. It's the island of Ireland. And I think like there is a lot of educational processes, you could say, at my age group that are the island of Ireland. Like, even looking into like horse racing Ireland, that we're obviously very connected with, is the island of Ireland between north and south, because like horses don't know where the border is. And that's the same, like there's a lot of different kind of educational purposes. Like there's a grad program you can do in Kildangan with Godolphin. There's grad programs in the National Stud, and they're all the island of Ireland, as is Caffrey up in Enniskillen. But speaking of which, like I think one of the main things that could be implemented, or that if they were, could have changed our path, is cross-border missions. So we always hear about state visits and state missions, but where are the cross-border missions? Like, especially now with Minister Poots and Minister McConnell, the fact that they're both ministers of agriculture, they're both Ulster men, like there's no reason as to why they couldn't set up cross-border trade missions, maybe like setting up trade fairs in the ploughing, in the RDS, in Balmoral Show. Like there's no reason why they couldn't be asking like the companies like ourselves and younger companies and older companies to be coming and setting up trade fairs. And I think that would really encourage people to look across the border, and that you'd have people going to the likes of Balmoral Show from as far down as Cork, and they'd be seeing these companies up north that are looking for exactly what they want, rather than having to go across the seas. And I think also maybe like approaching like an all-Ireland business awards. Like we hear about all-Ireland, we hear about the north, we hear about everything like that, but maybe like all-Ireland business awards would kind of encourage people again to see their competitors across the border. Do you know, see who are they going to be up against across the border in specific categories that they could eventually partner with or work with. And I think it's very much just trying to make that all island approach. And I think one thing that was missing when we started off was when we had all these questions about setting up the North, England, Scotland, it was that we didn't know who to go to. I think if there was like civil servants set up, maybe two in Belfast, one to look after North and South, and two in Dublin look after North and South, that they were the go-to person for business people. Again, maybe they're there, but just the awareness isn't there. And it would be that all you have to do is pick up the phone to whoever it may be and be like, I'm looking to go into the North. What do I need to do for legislation, labeling, anything like that? And I think it's just breaking it down, making it easier for businesses to go that extra step and just do those few extra miles over the border rather than swimming across the sea to England. I think it is just the simple things like that that would have helped us and that could help other companies.
Thank you, Kate. Those are really interesting points. And I'm pretty sure some of the people who have the answers to some of those questions are on this call right now or are on this video link right now. So I would really encourage you to please do come join the conversation, join the chat. The chat isn't only for questions. It can also be for you just to share your views around these issues. Do you think these ideas from the entrepreneurs are good? Are they feasible? Are there programs already out there that you're aware of that maybe people just need to know more about, which would answer some of these needs? So please do come and join us. Before that, Sean, I'm going to go to you with the same question. And I guess it is somewhat harder in that the others have already come up with lots of really good ideas. So being the third person is probably not the easiest, but can you think of anything else that would make it easier for young entrepreneurs to take an all-island approach to their businesses?
I can't just say, yeah, I agree with the other two guys because they've answered excellently, but it is very similar. When we first started, I was on an enterprise platform in DKIT or the RDC, and I think it's called the New Frontiers now, but it was fantastic for us. It brought in experts and we got exposed to the patent attorneys and all sorts of things that were some very, very good at the time, some were useful as we grew down the line. But it was very much covered in Republic of Ireland, and some of the changes and tweaks would be focused on North, and we weren't exposed to that until we then came north, and then we were getting the northern kind of view on it. It is, and Kate said it as well, it's almost, and Deepa, it's almost that there probably are people there who are probably on this call or somewhere saying that's what I do and I can help with that. But it is the awareness of it, is that understanding, and especially as when you're in a young startup mode, some of these things can be completely daunting and can be like overwhelming. So being able to speak to, instead of having to speak to somebody who's looking after the South and there's an expert, and someone who's looking after the North and they're an expert, and all of a sudden we're kind of going, well, which way is it? Having somebody who can represent both sides and point out pros and cons of both sides. Because when we're coming through this, that's what would happen. We'd meet somebody who's looking after the Sidd and Dock region and beyond, and then someone from Newry. They're both saying similar things, but obviously both vying for our business to be based on it. So trying to understand and put themselves in the position of the business. So what's best for that business at that time? People will often told us throughout the years, you don't make long-term business decisions based on short-term things like government support. But also you don't make long, you don't want to be thinking, well, hold on, let's go south for corporation tax because it's going to be great in 10 years when we're really, really big. So what's best for the business is not often the viewpoint that's always taken. And trying to have somebody who's maybe sitting in between and trying to help businesses in that front is maybe something. And as I said, there's probably somebody going, no, that's what I do, or our department does, but it's getting out there in front of these businesses. And that's a challenge. I'm not saying it's easy, but trying to get in front of these up and coming businesses, because even in the space that we're in sports and in tech, there are businesses in Dublin. I met a guy just this week who's based outside Belfast who we share clients with. There's three companies in Northern Ireland along with ourselves who are in the elite sports business. And we've known each other, we met each other through our industry, but we've never kind of come up along the same paths and had the same story. So there's gaps there that need to be filled as well.
So if there are people on this call who are saying, this is exactly what I do, please do come and join the conversation. For now, Sean, I want to ask you, do you think that because you're based close to the border, you had more exposure to cross-border opportunities, and that it's maybe easier for a company based in Dundalk or something like that to look cross-border than a company based in Cork, because people don't really think cross-border when they're in Cork that far south?
Yeah, probably. It's human nature. And even to Kate's point earlier, even when I was growing up, you don't always look north, even from a personal point of view, even if it's socializing. Like I'm in between Dundalk and Newry, but I was always, it was Dundalk where I went to school and everything. But so naturally we're closer to it now. And as things are changing, it's easier for us to maximize the opportunities north and south. But so it would be, we are at an advantage at that point. But likewise, we have manufacturing facilities that we use in Enniskillen, but also in Cork. So we have to stop seeing, I suppose, the north as something that's border counties are favouring it. If it's, as Kate said, if someone from Cork or beyond should be, and again, it comes back to, it's the mindset, we should be opening ourselves to it. And if it's going to change, it's up to people like ourselves to change it. We can't sit and wait for someone to make the introductions, as much as I said in my previous point, but we have to drive it. We have to start from a mindset of, well, we're all sitting on this island, about 6 million people. There's definitely somebody who can help it. And that could be somebody in the north thinking, we need to expose ourselves more to people down in Cork and Dublin and so on, and vice versa. It's not just the south looking north, it's the north looking south. And yeah, I've probably been on both sides of that conversation.
Thank you so much. I'm now going to bring in Lorraine Corker, Director of Social Enterprise, ROI. Hopefully we have Lorraine on screen in a second. Yes, there we go. Thank you very much, Lorraine. Welcome.
Hi, how are you? Thanks a million for inviting me to this. It's great to see this conversation happening. I'm a Director of Social Enterprise Republic of Ireland, and we're the representative body for social enterprises in the Republic. We have a sister organisation who operate in the north. It's Social Enterprise Northern Ireland, and they've actually been established longer than us. And I suppose we've both got pieces where we can learn from each other. And we work very closely, and we have formed a partnership. And one of the things we're looking at is setting up joint events whereby we can have peer-to-peer learning, where we can enhance collaborations. And I think it's interesting even using that example of how do you broaden this outside of the border counties, because we'd be very keen for all Ireland social enterprises to be able to work together, and it doesn't matter on your immediate geography. And I'd be keen to hear from the panelists on any shared learnings they could have in terms of, you know, we could, I suppose, get this up and running and make it as impactful as possible, because clearly what we're doing is similar to what other representative bodies are doing and supporting business. Thanks a million.
Okay, thank you so much for that, Lorraine. Has anyone from the panel got any particular thoughts on how this could be made particularly impactful? If you want to raise your actual hand, I'll come to you. Other than that, I will just pick somebody. Okay, Sean, thank you.
I suppose it's a fairly broad question, but from my point of view, if you almost try and specialize in, if it's be it workshops or get-togethers. For me, it's the formal setting of kind of this is what we're on is good, but it's very hard to, webinars have become a thing, and as people start to get out and meet again, it's definitely something that we feel is more valuable as well. But people coming into a networking environment, but making it specific and trying to break it down into certain industries or to complementary industries, as opposed to just being a big broad brush and this is going to be an open door thing for everything north and south, trying to break it down into something that might be agricultural specific and then trying to tap into those industries. That for me, I'm more inclined to see the benefits in something that I know is going to be something that I can garner information from or get context or increase my understanding. If it's a very kind of broad brush approach, there might be chunks of that don't really apply, and you'll find people might switch off a little bit. So it's probably an obvious thing to say, but that'd be a definitely approach I'd be taking.
That's actually really helpful, Sean.
Just like to jump in and say that I think that's really sort of a good idea in terms of what Sean's saying, but maybe take a sector and do a bit of research and test what the need is and what the demand is and run that as the pilot before scaling up would be my suggestion.
Okay, great, Deepa. And Kate, any further thoughts?
No, I've no further thoughts. I think what Sean said is a very good point. But also I do agree with Deepa. I think there's no point in pumping money, resources, everything into this, and then for it not to work out that year as well, to get that small group, get that pilot group and test it out on them first, because if it doesn't work in a small group, realistically, it won't work in a larger group. So definitely what Sean and Deepa said.
Okay, thank you. So we're down to our last 5 minutes or so. We do have a number of comments from the audience, which I'm delighted to see. Unfortunately, you're going to have to make them pretty briefly. First up, Emer O'Gorman from Fingal County Council and Dublin Belfast Economic Corridor.
Thanks very much, and a really interesting discussion here today. The Taoiseach referenced the Dublin Belfast Economic Corridor as one of these examples of shared island working, the 8 local authorities. So it's just really, I suppose we would have done a little bit of work with Sean in a promo piece recently. What we're trying to achieve is exactly that. It's like clusters of businesses coming together to share their experiences and learn from each other on that kind of north-south collaboration piece. Okay, ours is specifically targeted from Belfast all the way down to Dublin, but there's nothing to say that the learnings from those shared experiences can't be applied and used in other areas. So we will be kind of reaching out to the kind of broader business community in the coming weeks and months, looking for businesses to participate in that clustered development of ideas. So it's just really to say that we're here and we're ready to listen to the businesses there, and we're open to help where we can in that space. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Emer. That's great to hear and great to know. Next, we have Margaret Harty from Intertrade Ireland.
Thanks, Laura. I am on. Can you hear me, Laura?
Welcome, Margaret.
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted the panel raise some really interesting points this afternoon. So it was one of the, you heard from Ken Nelson, our Intertrade Ireland chairperson this morning, talk about Intertrade Ireland. I suppose the first point I wanted to make was that a lot of those services are currently, that the panel raised, provided by Intertrade Ireland. So I'd encourage you to visit our website, but it's clear that more needs to be done. And some of the points around the trade shows, and they're things that we have done in the past, but certainly we'll look at it again. All of the support for businesses to trade cross-border, whether that's regulatory advice, we currently provide that for businesses. So again, would encourage any business that's interested in trading cross-border, interested in finding out what the opportunity is for your business, to contact, go onto our website, or pick up the phone and speak to one of our members of staff. You know, I suppose one of the things we heard a lot about collaboration this morning. There's much more opportunities outside in terms of cross-border opportunities outside trade. There's the opportunity to collaborate with another business in the other jurisdiction to look at global opportunities. So the sum of what you can achieve working as in a partnership is much more than you can achieve independently. And again, we've a lot of supports for businesses to collaborate and joint innovation projects. and a lot of that happening at the moment. So making the plug, take a look at our website, get in contact with us on anything in terms of cross-border All-Ireland. We're very willing to help.
Okay, thank you very much, Margaret. We're almost out of time. I'm going to come very quickly to Joan Rhodes from the Health Innovation Research Alliance, Northern Ireland. Then we'll go back to the panel very briefly to ask them for their reaction to what they've just heard on the points. So Joan, very quickly, you want to make a point about the life, about the health and life sciences innovation across Ireland. And I think you're unfortunately on mute. Are we good?
I'm not yes. Unmuted.
There we go. Perfect.
Okay. Welcome. Maybe someone's unmuted me. Okay. Thank you. So just to point out very quickly, so I represent the Health Innovation Research Alliance Northern Ireland, which is the signpost for health and life sciences up here in the north. There's a sister or brother organisation down in the south, Health Innovation Hub Ireland. And we're just in the process of pulling together an MOU to develop such activities that the panel raised and have been, you know, busy taking notes there. I think an All-Ireland accelerator in health and life sciences sounds fantastic, and thinking about how we can join up other activities, particularly the opportunity around regulatory. Now we've got different regulations with respect to medicines and potentially health data as well, as things may diverge according to the Northern Ireland Protocol and an EU exit. So just to highlight that we are here, we've both got websites to reach out to us, and also working with InterTrade as well. So, you can reach out to us, but I think we do also need to do more to highlight that we're here to help those entrepreneurs and business owners and startups really develop those cross-border linkages.
That's excellent. Thank you so much for that, Joan. I'm going to briefly come back to the panel just to ask you guys if you're encouraged by those contributions that you've just heard. Deepa.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's I suppose this forum has highlighted the partnerships and opportunities that do already exist. The challenge, I guess, is getting that information to businesses that may be thinking of starting up or those that are already operating. And it's about getting that information to businesses in the right way at the right time to meet the right need. And that's probably where there's still a bit of work to be done. Yeah. And I do think in terms of Stephen's Orr's contributions earlier on, in terms of having perhaps a sectoral focus, but to sort of two key words have really resonated with me in terms of also ensuring that we have inclusive innovation in terms of the next generation of entrepreneurs, so that we're not missing talent and we're not missing opportunities.
Okay, thank you so much. And Deepa, thank you so much, Deepa. Kate, briefly, are you encouraged by what you've heard here today? Does it make you feel more optimistic about being able to maybe do more cross-border business?
Yeah, definitely. I think just hearing those comments there were, again, highlighting what's there that we don't know about. But also you could suggest that maybe like those associations that are providing all these services, that they could maybe like work closer with like Enterprise Ireland or the local county councils and things like that. Because I know when we started up, the first place we go was our local county council. So I think like even showing them that there's these other opportunities up north could broaden the horizon for new companies.
Thank you, Kate. That's an excellent point. And Sean, are you encouraged by what you've heard here today?
Yeah, absolutely encouraged. And like everyone said, there is a need for, I suppose, more getting it out there and kind of more awareness of it. But also looking, we have to always look at ourselves as well. And we can't expect people to come to us with all the answers, all the information. So we have to know, and it is going back to this cultural mindset and awareness that we have to be aware and kind of go and ask the right questions and go and poke around and look for it. I do think that there's been a bit of that as well, is that we've been closed off to it. There has to be this concept of we are an island and we can all work on this together. And we can't just expect people to hand us the information too. So there are two sides to it without question. Both sides can get better.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Sean. I'm sorry, we have run a little over time with this conversation. I thought it was an important conversation and important to draw in the audience and to get a lot of perspectives on it. So I hope you guys have found it useful. I've certainly really enjoyed it. Thank you so much to my panelists, to Deepa, Sean and Kate. And thank you also to everyone who joined the conversation and brought in those very important points.